Good evening, all the friends at the outset. I'll express my sincere thanks to IAB President Dr. Pakul Parekh and my dear friend Basavaraj for their presence. I feel honored. I sincerely thank the IAP Tamil Nadu State Chapter functionaries, Dr. Chendil President, Dr. Ismail President Elect, Dr. Suresh Balan Secretary, and Dr. Rajendran Treasurer. Thank you all for giving me this opportunity. Now we are going to, next 60 minutes, we are going to discuss about a common issue, which is poisoning in children. The poisoning in children, before discussing, I want to share the three things. One is, poisoning in children, when you manage them, it is something like you're running into a running into a suspicious story where everything is suspicious. You're going into a mysterious story where when a child is brought to the ER after 5 minutes of consuming something, you don't know whether he really consumed. That is the first suspense. Second is, if he has consumed, what poison is consumed. Third is, when you are explaining the parent that he may need to be observed in the hospital, gastric lavage, charcoal, samples, everything, known, the parents will be looking at a child who is jumping out from the car and running away. So you have to convince the parent that the poisoning children in their present, they usually remains normal. And then they started presenting with the symptoms only later. Second is, difference between adult and childhood poisoning is, adult, they consume poison mainly to declare themselves that they have consumed the poison. That is an objective and motive. But children, they don't express it. They might have consumed a poison, but we may not know. They present like any other medical emergency. They come with convulsions, altered sensory. We think about febrile seizures. We think about hypocalcemia. We think about metabolic encephalopathies. So there we have to identify the poisoning. That is up to the pediatrician to identify that child has consumed the poison. Third thing is, what we know about poison is, I just go with the next slide. Some difficulty in moving the slide. The third aspect is, this is the great aphorism of the poet Avayar, who lived 300 years before the birth of Christ. What we know is handful and what we don't know is sea size. It is exactly applicable for the knowledge in poisoning. All of us may deal with a lot of poisoning children, but our knowledge in poisoning is very, very little. And every time when you come across a child with poisoning, we have to refer, browse the net.
The slide is not shared, sir. Excuse me. Slides are not shared, sir. Wonderful, sir.
Third aspect, what I wanted to tell you is the great aphorism of poet Avayar, Kattadu Kayalavu Kalladu Ulagalavu. What we know about poisoning is handful. What we don't know is sea sized. So whenever we come across a child with poisoning, particularly it's more complicated, better read it, refer, discuss with your colleagues, and browse the net to identify what exactly we are dealing with. The poisoning is not confined only to a child and their family members. Sometimes it may be a cluster of children. Here is example, a midday meal tragedy in Bihar, July 2013. Children died after consuming the midday meals. Contamination of the food with the pesticides. Sometime it may affect the whole city. Bhopal tragedy, October 1984. Thousands of people died and lakhs of people were affected. Why the IAP DNSC Dr. Chendil has chosen this topic during the lockdown is explained by this slide. One of our residents, Dr. Lalita Rajalakshmi, analyzed these case scenarios. And generally, the poisoning cases will be in the range of 1.3 per thousand before the lockdown. After the lockdown declared, see, the incidence has increased 5.7 in April and 3.4 in May. To increase the incidence of poisoning during the lockdown period, it is very paradoxical. No, when everybody is inside the house, why the children, how the children can consume the poison? It is not only in India or Chennai, it is all over the world. It is the same, this thing was reported from Poison Information Center from Europe, Canada, and USA, that large number of poisoning cases are reported during the lockdown period because probably everybody is present physically, but they are not mentally present because they are looking after their own works. children are free at home, exposed to a lot of chemicals. See, this is data. Before lockdown, this is a list of poisons. After the lockdown, floor cleaner and hand sanitizer dominate the substances consumed because of the easy availability. You might think that I just start with alcohol. You might think that I don't have alcohol in my home. No. Lot of chemicals like mouthwashes contains 25 to 30%. You know how much is available in our sanitizer we use it, we keep it in over the table nowadays, contains 70% alcohol, more than the Scotch whiskey. So what are the classical features once they consumed? The features of aroma, and then they will have hypoglycemia, respiratory depression, depressed level of consciousness. They may need to correct hypoglycemia, they may need to correct metabolic acidosis, and they may need ventilatory support. Very complicated to analyze, but just to understand the fact that if the child consumes 1 ml per kg of sanitizer, a 10 kg child consuming 2 spoons, it is equivalent to almost intoxication of alcohol. That much it is dangerous. So anticipate, our house is not safer. It is a mini bar. We must be aware about it. Commonest poison is kerosene all over India. Every state you take, commonest poison reported in all the hospitals is kerosene. The national bird is peacock. National animal is tiger. National poison in children is kerosene. There's an 1.5-year-old child consumed kerosene, brought to ER of ICH after 2 hours. Comatose, look at X-ray. It's a massive aspiration, ERDS. Child was brought in gasping, shock, IV fluids, inotropes, ventilated. Unfortunately, we could not save the child. Child died after 5 hours because of massive aspiration, ERDS. So what are the risk factors to prognosticate the mortality? The child presents with altered sensorium or having recurrent seizures, or there is a need for ventilator support, it's very likely that we may not be able to save the child. Sorry, just a difficulty in adding the slides. So how does kerosene cause problems? One is it immediately replaces kerosene gas, replaces the FRC in the lungs with kerosene vapor that leads to hypoxia, chemical pneumonia, bacterial pneumonia, surfactant washout leading to ARDS, and sometimes very rarely it can cause necrotizing pneumonia, nematocele, and emphysema. What is the management? Observe for at least 6 hours if the child is asymptomatic. Oxygen administration immediately, even if the child is asymptomatic, if giving oxygen, will replace the kerosene vapor in the lungs so that child will immediately will be relieved of hypoxia. Antibiotics needed. We have to assess the child for need for respiratory support. Now, problem in moving the slides. So, is the management. So this is, sometimes the child may present like an extensive bronchopneumonia. Only when there is a distress, there is a need for X-ray chest. Gastric lavage is contraindicated. Oxygen is a prime caretaker for the kerosene ingestion. Surfactant is nowadays used for sicker ones. How to prevent this? Learning point is tell the parents not to store the kerosene water bottle beyond the reach of kids. These are the two case reports where you can see that there are two case reports where surfactant is successfully used in hydrocarbon aspiration and severe form of ARDS. So there is a way out. When a child develops ARDS and ventilated, he always have a negative result. So surfactant has come in the way to save these kids.
கொஞ்சம் முன்னால வந்துறீங்களா கம்ப்யூட்டர்ல பேர் சரியா தெரியல இப்ப நல்லா இருக்கு சார் இப்ப ஸ்லைட் ஷேர் ஆயிருக்கு சார் Okay.
Moving from there, we move to another case scenario. The commonest poison in children is kerosene. commonest poison consumed in adult is organophosphorus compound. Particularly rural males prefer alcohol and OPC. Rural female, they prefer oleander. Here, this mother and two children are admitted with suspicion of poisoning. Mother was admitted in a different hospital. The children had excessive salivation, anxiety, constricted pupil, bradycardia, muscle twitching. You look at the video. Look at this video, we can appreciate muscle twitching. It's a very important sign, give a clue that child has consumed OPC. But when we did the gastric lavage, it didn't show any smell. This shows the features of poisoning with OPC, but there is no smell in the gastric lavage. How it is possible? Because in a child with OPC poisoning, there must be a smell of OPC in the gastric lavage. That is not there. So before going into the case, we'll see what are the problems with OPC is muscarinic effects, nicotinic effects, and CNS effects. Main problem with the nicotinic effects only because they cause fasciculation, respiratory paralysis, bradycardia, tachycardia, and arrhythmia. Muscarinic effects are mainly sludge and dumbbells with excessive salivation, lacrimation. There are relatively benign problems. CNS problems are also dangerous like headache, dizziness, confusion, drowsiness, hyperglycemia, glycosuria, and convulsions. The wholly suspect poisoning is mainly by clinical appearance and then estimation of the cholinesterase levels. Can you prognosticate? Can you stratify what is the severity? It's possible with taking into account of three things. Two clinical factors, level of consciousness and respiratory effort. And third is serum acetylcholinesterase levels if it's possible for you. The child comes walking, has only abdominal pain and vomiting, it's mild. Child is conscious but restless, cannot walk with meiosis, soft voice, it is moderate. The child is unconscious, no pupillary reflex, convulsions present, flaccid paralysis, it is severe. The proportionate severity is also expressed by the serum ACHE levels. How do you manage? Mainly decontamination is very important. GI decontamination, gastric lavage, charcoal is not useful. You have to give bath to the child, quickly wash the body, and then apply, you have to lavage the eyes even with the normal saline. Oxygen, monitoring the vitals, IV atropine 0.05 milligram per kg every 10 minutes till the atropine sensation occurs. Atropine sensation means drying of the secretions. Then gradually you can reduce the frequency. P2AM is controversial, but still WHO advises that all the children, all the patients suspected to consume OPC has to receive P2AM. 30 milligram per kg in normal saline over 30 minutes can be repeated IV dose after 8 hours or can be given an continuous infusion is 8 milligram per kg per hour. Sometimes after atropine, they may develop tachycardia, severe tachycardia and restlessness where you may not be able to give atropine. In those situations, glycopyrrolate is a simple substitute. But remember, it does not prevent the central oleic anticholinergic effects. Very importantly, we have to monitor the respiratory effort, both rate and effort, because anytime child may need a respiratory support, may need to be intubated and ventilated. So child needs to be carefully monitored for the respiratory rate and effort. There are some drugs are contraindicated. Aminophylline, because it antagonizes the P2AM. Morphine is metabolized by cholinesterase. So morphine and scholine, aminoglycosides are contraindicated in a child with OPC poisoning. Apart from the acute symptom, there are two other problems can occur. One is called intermediate syndrome. You may think that by fourth day, child is coming out of the acute symptoms. But that time, child can go into intermediate syndrome where the child may develop head lag and again the respiratory weakness and muscle weakness may reappear. It's a warning that child may need respiratory support. No need to continue the antidotes. OPC-induced polyneuropathy can occur after 1 to 4 weeks. We already discussed that P2AM is controversial, is indicated only in organophosphates, not in carbamates. But how to identify the carbamates from the poisonous substances? Fortunately, most of the traders, the name given is self-explain about the presence of carbamate. So mostly the carb is in the first prefix or postfix, like for example, bufencarb, aldicarb, carbaryl, methiocarb. So this gives an idea whether the compound contains carbamate or not. Remember, we might think that I'm in a city, my child may not be exposed to OPC, because unlike in rural areas, that is not true, because many surface and room sprays we use in our homes, cockroach baits, head lice shampoos, pet washes for a dog and cat, all these contains low dose of OPC compounds. Remember about it. We have 2-3 children after consuming Headley shampoo was presented with severe features of OPC poisoning. So what WH has done is given a color code on the container. I told you to identify the problems from the container itself. Is the red label means extremely toxic compound. These are the extremely toxic compounds. Yellow label is highly toxic. These are the endosulfan, carbaryl, those things. Blue label is moderately toxic. Green label is means slightly toxic. So all the household insecticide generally comes under slightly toxic OPCs. But remember, if the child is smaller and the consumption is larger, that itself can lead to serious symptoms. Coming back to this child, the child received atropine P2AM. We are able to save this both the kids. But the first question is not answered. Is it really OPC or not? Because there is no smell. So whenever you are in a problem, always apply the toxidrome concept. From the toxidrome only, like a consider people, convulsion, we could suspect that it could be OPC. Here, why there is no smell is, we later collected the history from the mother after she recovered is, she used to inject insulin to her father. So out of depression, what she took the OPC liquid, took it in a syringe, injected to herself as well as to the babies to avoid missing the poison. That is why we didn't have any smell. So what is the learning point from this case scenario is there was features of OPC, but there is no smell in the gastric acid. Why? Think about alternate toxins or alternate routes. We are all along thinking about a oral route. In fact, it was even as an intramuscular route. That's a very rare thing which we learned from this case. Third one is, anything given in large number will get into us to problems. So whatever the medicines we give to the patients in large numbers, iron tablets we give, enobarbitone, isoniazid, phenytoin, all this land up with poisoning and problems. This is a child suspected of consuming 10 tablets available at home, but parents did not able to tell the name. We could not identify. They didn't bring the bottle also. But in the ER itself, child was drowsy and passed black stools. Child developed shock, managed the ringer lactate. In the meantime, within 2 hours, we were able to collect the biochemical report, which was transaminase were high. These three gave the clue. Are you able to give the clue? Are you able to understand the clue? Here we have a child who has got a bleeding tendency, GA bleeding, transaminitis, alter sensorium. So there are only three poisons can cause this: paracetamol, iron, and isoniazid. Isoniazid usually will present with intractable seizures. Paracetamol poisoning will cause GA bleeding only on the third day, not on the first day. So more likely to be iron. Iron, first 24 hours, here GA bleeding and black stools with shock and hyperglycemia, acidosis. More likely that you are dealing with a child with iron poisoning. Paracetamol and the rodenticide, the rat killer, usually cause GA bleeding after third or fourth day. These are the differentiating points. The child was given gastric lavage. Remember, activated charcoal will not be useful in this poisoning like iron. But whole bowl irrigation is very useful. I will explain in the next few slides when we try to explain the overview of poisoning. Here we given gastric lavage and whole bowl irrigation. You are able to see the small pellets of iron tablets in the diaper. So I'm in a periphery. Here in a teaching institution, immediately you can take the sample. Then for serum ion, general rule is for any poison, you want to take the serum level is, general rule is 4 hours. That's the maximum peak will be seen only in 4 hours. So after 4 hours, they take the serum levels and send for iron poisoning. But here I'm in a periphery, I'm in a district headquarters. I don't know how much I may be able to get a serum iron levels. Even if I get it, it may after 48 hours. So these are the simple clues to decide whether the antidote is needed or not. If the child is consumed 60 milligram per kg, remember again, 6 milligram per kg is the normal iron dosage. 10 times the dosage, 60 milligram per kg is consumed from the history. Then antidote is needed. Severe symptoms. WBC, they're all simple investigation which give a clue. WBC count is 15,000. Serum glucose is 150 milligram. These are all the simple clues to tell us that our child may require difluoxamine or the antidote. You have the serum level, anything above 350 microgram per ml is significant. If the child has got high anion gamma metabolic acid, another indication. The X-ray abdomen is a simple investigation to identify iron tablets, residual pellets in the abdomen. You can see a lot of, I took it from the net. You can see radiopaque shadows, which indicate that child has taken a significant amount of iron. So how to give defloxamine? 15 milligram per kg per hour as an IV infusion. It is given maximum dose is 6 grams, but general duration is only 24 hours. I'll repeat, 15 milligram per kg per hour as IV infusion only for 24 hours. Once we start defloxamine will combine with iron and form a complex, which will cause a color called wind rose appearance. It's a reddish rose color appearance. You can see in the catheterized tube as well as in the urine bag. And once it is cleared, then it's indication that we have eliminated the iron. So when to stop deferoxamine? After the acidosis is corrected, or after the Winrose color of the urine is cleared. Here you see the Winrose color, but it's clear here. After 12 to 24 hours, when the patient is clinically improving, but general rule is do not continue deferoxamine beyond 24 hours because it may not give good benefit. At the same time, there is also a risk of ARDS. So what is the lesson learned from this child? The child came with GA bleeding, shock and hyperglycemia. So always consider use a toxidrome concept. GA bleeding means only three, INH, paracetamol, and then iron. If facility is available, check the serum levels. Now we'll move on to the fifth case scenario. This is one of the very, very common drug we use in day-to-day practice, even in the OTC is available, paracetamol. If you see a child with 5 days fever, hepatomegaly, raised hepatic enzymes, generally, I will think about viral hepatitis, I may think about dengue, I may think about leptospirosis. Remember, in addition to these diseases, you should also consider paracetamol toxicity as one of the important reasons. Anything in excess is poisonous, even paracetamol. Here, this is a prescription which is covered and I shared the prescription. Here, if you are able to see the prescription, it is written as, very nicely written as 0.8 ml, 3 to 4 times. Beautiful handwriting, very clear handwriting. Nobody can miss it. 0.8 ml, 3 to 4 times. Nobody can find fault with this prescription. But after giving this prescription, when I reviewed a child after 3 days, the mother came and told, sir, fever-ஏ குறையல. I am giving this medicine for 3 days. நீங்க சொன்ன மாதிரி 8 ml கொடுத்துட்டிருக்கேன் சார். ஃபீவரே குறையல சார். 8 ml கொடுத்தோட குறையல. She repeated it. Then I got a shock of my day. But then I didn't worry about a fever. I was worried about a paracetamol because she has given how much dose? 10 times the higher dose. 10 times a toxic dose. So I had to explain the parent that child was hospitalized in ICU, received NAC and then child recovered. So remember, these are all the problems what we will face.
சார் ஸ்லைட் ஷோக்கு போயிருந்தீங்களா சார் ஸ்லைட் ஷோக்கு போயிட்டீங்கன்னா ஈஸியாக இருக்கும்
இல்லை தெர் இஸ் ஸ்லைட் ஷோ தான் இருக்கேன் பட் தெர் இஸ் சம் டிஃபிகல்டி இன் மூவிங் த ஸ்லைட் தட்ஸ் அ ப்ராப்ளம் ஸோ ஹவு த பாராசமல் டாக்ஸி இவால்வ் வாட் இஸ் அ டாக்ஸிக் டோஸ் இஸ் 200 மில்லிகிராம் பர் கேஜி அண்ட் அபோவ் இஸ் அ டாக்ஸிக் டோஸ் இட் கோஸ் இன் டு த்ரீ ஃபேஸஸ் ஃபோர் ஃபேஸஸ் ஃபேஸ் ஒன் இஸ் அந்த டே ஒன் ஆஃப்டர் கன்சூமிங் பாராசிட்டமால் சைல்டு வில் பி கம்ப்ளீட்லி ஏசிம்டமேட்டிக் ஆர் மே ஹவ் ஒன்லி நான் ஸ்பெசிஃபிக் சிம்டம்ஸ் லைக் நாசியா வாமிட்டிங் Phase 2, they will have hepatomegaly, tenderness right epicondrium, elevated transaminases and elevated bilirubin, which will closely resemble a picture of a viral hepatitis. One two important clues is rise in the creatinine and falling bicarbonate indicate that we are might be dealing with a child with paracetamol toxicity. And phase 3, we have already gone into multi-organ involvement, jaundice, renal failure, lactic acidosis, coagulopathy, hepatic central wall necrosis. Encephalopathy, this is a stage, even when we give the antidotes, we may not be able to save the child. Fortunately, most of our children fall into phase 1 and phase 2, we are able to save those kids. This is the nomogram, Rumack-Matthew nomogram, and what situations where nomograms may not be useful. If the sample is taken before 2 hours or after 24 hours, your nomogram may not show the correct results. It is not useful. Again, this nomogram is useful only for single dose injection. A child has consumed a full bottle of paracetamol. There it will be useful. By mistake, parents are giving a larger dose, 5 times, 6 times. In those situations, the nomogram may not be useful. So multiple dose injection or sample taken beyond 24 hours or before 4 hours, this nomogram may not be useful. Sorry about the sharing. So the, how much NSL system? This is the dose given in the textbooks. Very, very difficult to remember. Peroral and IV. Now a simple dosage schedule has come where you can give 150 milligram per kg loading dose followed by 150 milligram per kg followed by with the slides. Loading dose is 150 milligram per kg over 1 hour, followed by 10 milligram per kg per hour for 48 to 72 hours. This is the simple dosage schedule, even in a critical care textbook. So this will be a very useful one for us to remember. So how to prepare the infusion? That will be the most of the time many of my colleagues used to come call and ask. So 1 ml of NAC is 200 milligram. Dilute 1 ml with 24 ml of D5. This will be very useful for those in the peripheries. 1 ml mixed to 24 ml of D5 should be dissolved only in D5, not normal saline. 1 ml will give 8 milligram. 1 ml of solution will give 8 milligram. For younger kids, you can use this formula. For older kids, you can use 3 ml of NAC plus 22 ml of D25, where 1 ml of solution will be giving 24 milligram per ml. So this calculation will be useful for those in the peripheries. So anything that makes you weak physically, intellectually, and spiritually is considered as poison. Now we'll go through some of the common overview, common general characteristics of a poisoning. This is the stepwise management of a poison. First is, step one is resuscitate. Like any other medical emergency, assess the child by pulse procedures and resuscitate the child. And try to recognize by history and examination or by toxidrome. Decide if the antidote is available, use antidote. Continue to monitor the child. But remember, when the child enters into ER, remember to make an ER entry. When we discharge a child, remember to educate the parents about not having a similar situation in the future. So most of the poisons may cause a respiratory failure, either because like kerosene can cause lung failure or central depression can cause pump failure. So protection of the airway is important. Keep low threshold for intubation. Generally, we'll postpone intubation for any medical emergency, but in poisoning, we have to keep a low threshold. We may have to intubate a little more earlier than other periodic emergencies. May need only brief support. When we use drugs like muscle relaxant, Vicronium is preferred to succinylcholine, particularly when we are intubating a child with OPC poisoning. When the child comes in shock, what to do? Like an iron poisoning with shock, we have to give 10 ml per kg boluses. When the child comes in cardiogenic shock, we have to be very careful not to give more fluids. Maybe we'll be giving only 5 ml per kg. Cardiogenic shock can happen with poisoning with tricyclic antidepressant, calcium channel blocker, beta blocker, and oleander poisoning. So whenever a child comes in altered sensorium, we suspect or seizures, we suspect poisoning. Remember, hypoxemia, hypoglycemia, and hypocalcemia are important cause for seizures. When we correct them, most of the time it may get corrected. That is very, very important learning point for us. Problem with the moving the slide. Sorry about it. Don't know the fault where it is. So this is a simple algorithm for a child presenting with seizures with a suspected toxin ingestion. Remember, is a household substance or medicine? If it's a household substance, a child with seizures, the background of toxin ingestion, camphor, neem oil, OPC, gamaxin, these are all. We check the glucose. If there is low glucose, it is oral hypoglycemic agent or beta blocker. If the glucose is higher, it is isoniazid or theophylline. If the sugar is normal, it is tricyclic antidepressant. So this simple algorithm will be helpful to identify that. But remember, during seizure management, always correct the metabolic problem like hypoglycemia. Use benzodiazepines. If you suspect INH, use pyridoxine. But phenytoin is contraindicated in all children with seizures secondary to poisoning. Sir, metabolic problem like hypoglycemia and metabolic acidosis. Hypoglycemia can be caused. Salicylate, methanol, cyanide, and metformin. To have a simple, crude analysis of toxins and system involved, if you have a child with poisoning, has only respiratory involvement, main problem is hydrocarbons. Only respiratory problems, then it is hydrocarbons. If it is circulatory problems, if it is bradycardia, oleander, or oduvandhalai, or digoxin, if it is tachycardia, tricyclic antidepressants. If CVS, CNS, and tricyclic both are involved, it's more likely to be tricyclic antidepressants. The RS and CNS are affected, mainly it is OPC. If a child develops fatal symptoms, a death within 5 to 15 minutes, or serious symptoms following consumption of poison, it is cyanide poison. Pupil is a window to identifying the type of poison. If it is meiosis, constricted pupil in phenobarbital, opium, and OPC, dilated people in belladonna, tricyclic antidepressant, cocaine. It's not moving.
So we'll ask the technical person to help, sir. Mr. Samir?
Don't know whether it is.
Samir?
So we have resuscitated child. Recognize. Can you call them in the meantime? I will continue.
Okay. Please continue. Samir is available.
Okay. Then targeted history. We discussed earlier that most of the kids come without history of poisoning. If they come with witness history of poisoning, there are five W's. Who has consumed? What are the age and height of the child? Age and weight of the child? What poison? When? The time of exposure? Why? Accidental or intentional? How much? If it is an unwitnessed poisoning, a clue for history taking is would. W for where? Where the accident has occurred, where the event has occurred. Suppose the child is found unconscious inside a car or in a closed room in AC working, more likely to be carbon monoxide poisoning. Then, odor. The child comes with a kerosene smell or a garlic odor, you can think about OPC. If there are any other victims involved, any drugs were found in the proximity, any open bottles or powders in the lips, all this will give a clue about the targeted history. We already discussed about convulsions, bradycardia, everything. And then we'll go for decontamination.
Can you wait for a few seconds? Slide is not shared actually.
Slide not shared, no?
Meantime, I'll get some help. Sir.
Just repeat, there are target history taking, there are five W's. If there is an unwitnessed, can I keep like this? Five W's in a witnessed poisoning, who, what poison, when, why, and how much. In unwitnessed, it is where, wood is the mnemonic, where the events occurred. Suppose inside a car, inside a closed room, you think of carbon monoxide poisoning, odor. Other victims in presence of drugs in the proximity. And we move on to decontamination procedure. There are three decontamination procedures. One is gastric lavage, activated charcoal, or whole bowl irrigation. Gastric lavage is indicated if they come within 1 hour of ingestion. Contraindications are three C's, that is decreased conscious level, corrosive poison, volatile hydrocarbons. So how to do the gastric lavage? Gastric lavage should not be done like they do it in adult with a big stomach wash tube. It should be done by a 10 French nasogastric tube. Check the position. Put the child in the left lateral position with the head and low. Give 10 ml per kg of normal saline aqueous. It's not a simple water. or salt water. Both are, I have done this, both the mistakes. Giving water wash or salt water wash, both will cause hypo and hypernatremia. We have to use a normal saline aliquot, 10 ml per kg, instilled into the nasogastric tube and repeat till the returns are clear. See, this is why we insist on left lateral position. This is left lateral position where it increases the gastric content so that it is quickly drained and there is less passage beyond the pylorus so that to promote absorption. But if you put in the right lateral position, it's actually the dependent position, non-dependent position where it may not be drained well. In fact, it will promote passage of the poison into the across the pylorus. So always keep the child in the left lateral position during the gastric lavage. Now, the second important one is the activated charcoal. Most of the time, I just ask all the participants, how many of you have activated charcoal in your clinic or hospitals? Very, very important one. I think very important. Whenever you come to Chennai, Coimbatore or Madurai, please purchase the activated charcoal. If you buy 1 kg, which will be costing around 300, 400 rupees, at the most 500 rupees, will come for 5 years. But it's a very, very important component of decontamination is activated charcoal. It acts like an enteral dialysis. Not only it remove the drug in the intestines, it also remove the drugs which are absorbed beyond the epithelium. So its maximum benefit is within 1 hour. In a child, a conscious child, you can mix the water or juice so that to improve the taste and ask them to drink. In a child who is very young child, you can give through a nasogastric tube. You can see our nurse administering the charcoal. Most of the time, its tolerability is very good. Contraindications are aspiration only. Only when the child is dyspneic, probably you have to intubate and then do the gastric lavage. Otherwise, most of the conscious children will tolerate this. Dose is 1 gram per kg to be mixed with 4 to 8 parts of water. You might ask how to measure this 1 gram per kg. Think a child 10 gram. Simple measurement is you take a 5 ml paracetamol syrup. 1 spoon is 5 gram. 2 spoons is 10 grams. That is a simple calculation. It is useful in most of the poisons. One of the important questions asked for postgraduates, where the activated charcoal fails, P for pesticides, H for hydrocarbons, A for alcohol, I for iron, L for lithium, and S for solvents. These poisons, activated charcoal may not be useful. Very importantly, it may not be useful in iron poisoning. That is why we have to depend on whole bowl irrigation. So now we come to the third part of the decontamination process, whole bowl irrigation. So what is the substance used here? It's a PEG-like solution, which is commonly used by surgeons and gastroenterologists. This solution is prepared and given through the nasogastric tube, either as a continuous instillation or give us a 10 ml per kg every hour. You have to continue to give this. It literally washes out the intestines for the rectal effluent. Till the rectal effluent clear, we have to continue. Then you can see this diaper containing the particles. Indications are iron, sustained release preparations like enteric-coated medications, slow release potassium, and packets of vial containing cocaine and other illicit drugs. Other methods are all abandoned. Salt, emesis, ipica, cathartics, force alkaline diuresis, universal antidote are all abandoned. But remember, very, very, very important one is, in most of our headquarters and small hospitals, we have nephrologists and dialysis machines. So these are all the poisons where a refractory, not responding to antidote and management, in the poisoning due to isoniazid, acid, barbiturates, lithium, salicylate, methanol, ethanol, theophyllins, the dialysis will be a very, very useful one. So we have to utilize the services of dialysis and the nephrologist. This is the position statement of American Academy of Poison Centers and Association, European Association of Poison Center and Clinical Toxicity. What they say is, after 1 hour, gastric lavage and charcoal is not at all useful. But remember, but we'll have to continue, even if it is beyond 1 hour, continue to do the gastric lavage, but in a safer manner, because most of our parents may not know the exact timing in which they consumed it. So we'll have to continue gastric lavage, even if it come after 2 to 3 hours, gastric lavage and charcoal can be given. Why? Because unreliable history, they may not be given correct history, what exactly, what time it was consumed. Second is, they go into medical issues. Our lawyers do not read the PCNA and BMJ. So they may question why, even after 3 hours, 4 hours, why it was not done. So by doing it, we don't do any harm. Only that should be done in a very safe manner. Now we'll move on to the toxidrome. So how to identify the poison? These are all the list of toxidrome. Toxidrome, if the clinical, you look at the clinical symptoms, toxidrome is, the definition of toxidrome is a clinical constellation of clinical features which indicate a poison consumed. So for example, cholinergic, abdominal pain, fasciculation, hypertension, tachycardia, seizures, you think about OPC poison. You have anticholinergic poison like dilated pupil, tachycardia, hyperthermia, dry skin, you think of antihistamines or tricyclic antidepressants. Again, you can also go in for system-wise toxidromes. If there is a myocardial depression, you think about beta blocker, calcium channel blocker, and oleander. If there is hepatotoxicity, then the diagnosis narrowed down to paracetamol, rat killer, isoniazid, and those things. So toxidrome is knowing the toxidrome will be very, very useful to identify the poison. So what investigation you are going to do? So you will do all the investigation you generally do for emergency. In addition, you'll do ABD, ECG, X-ray abdomen, and toxicology screening. So in the toxicology screening, usually we send the gastric lavage for assessing the toxins, blood for quantitative assay, and urine for qualitative assay. But most of the time, this will not be helpful. This toxic assay will not be helpful. Mostly toxidrome is the one which is going to be helpful. If fortunately child has consumed a poison which we have antidotes, it will be really useful. So these are all the list of antidotes: iron, desferoxamine, opiate, naloxone, paracetamol, N-acetylcysteine, methemoglobinemia, methylene blue, INH, both injection as well as tablet pyridoxine. I just want you to have a copy of this one. All these antidotes must be preserved, must be available in our hospital. Because not having antidote is not the proper explanation. One of a child with methemoglobinemia, we have to wait for almost 12 to 18 hours to get IV methylene blue. That was in 2000. Nowadays, we are all well prepared to manage emergencies. This is a picture. This is the last scene of the movie Anbe Sivam, where this man will come to kill the hero. Finally, he will leave him without killing. Then he will say that you are my God because you have saved my life. So antidote is something similar to that. Antidote is going to save the life of a child. It's almost like a god in the puja room. So antidote must be available in all the hospitals and small hospitals and clinics. These are the list of antidotes to be stored. Whenever you buy antidotes, most of the time administration will object to that, saying that you bought naloxone, you bought N-acetylcysteine, but now it is expired. You just convince them saying that I buy the fire extinguisher for any anticipated fire accident. Just because I bought a fire extinguisher doesn't mean that I should have a fire accident. So all these antidotes are bound to expire. That is a good sign. Our beautiful devils, our kids, children, they will consume whatever they come across because their tendency to try everything oral. These are all the fortunately list of non-toxic substances. When they consume and come to the ER, we can reassure them saying that all these are non-poison, antacids, antibiotics, candle, calamine, lipstick, ink, deodorants, pencil lead, ink, crayon, shaving cream, toothpaste. All these are non-toxic substances for which the child need not be hospitalized. Maybe we can observe the child for 2-3 hours in the ER or OP, and then you can review the child as an outpatient after 12 or 24 hours. So I've quickly gone through the general characteristics of poisoning. We'll move on to the case scenarios. This is a very complex and problematic child we managed. This is a 14-year-old girl returned from school at 4 p.m. The mother was single mother, returned from work at 9 p.m. When I saw her, she was lying unconscious in the bed. And she vomited a fluid like this, a reddish fluid. So she was taken to a nearby hospital where was diagnosed as varicelle bleeding, and then child was referred as varicelle bleeding. When the child came to us, child was very sick. Convulsing, altered sensorium shock, we stabilized ABC, intubated and ventilated the child, and then started looking at what is the problem, poison which has consumed. But we were not convinced the diagnosis of varicelle bleeding, because varicelle bleeding cannot cause convulsion and altered sensorium. So whenever you come across a problem like this, sudden loss of consciousness, think about this rule of five, unidentified injury, unwitnessed seizures, envenomation, poisoning, or cerebrovascular accident. So after stabilizing ABC, we did the CT. CT was normal, which excluded cerebrovascular accident as well as traumatic brain injury, leaving only these two as a differential diagnosis, poisoning and unwitnessed seizures. Envenomation we did not consider because child was living in the fourth floor where the snake bite is less likely. So we thought of poisoning. The next question is, if there is a poisoning, how to analyze further? These are all the four drugs which can cause convulsion. These are the toxic substances. Toxic substances generally consumed by young kids. Drugs are mainly consumed by older children. Sorry, these are the four drugs which are likely to cause convulsions: tricyclic antidepressant, theophylline, oral antidiabetic. Tricyclic antidepressant, classical features are dilated pupil and then tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia. But this child did not have tachycardia or dilated pupil, so that is less likely. Theophylline can cause tachycardia and metabolic acid. Again, there is no tachycardia. Oral antidiabetic child will cause hypoglycemia, but here the child had slightly a higher glucose, 200 milligram. Child had hyperglycemia, metabolic acidosis, HAGMA, Then we thought probably INH may be a reason for it. It can cause hyperglycemia, metabolic acidosis, and convulsions, particularly intractable seizures. This one we already seen that, but I just want to reiterate that the classical triad we see here is a convulsion, high metabolic and hyperglycemia. So we narrowed down that this could be probably an INH overdose. At the same time, additional clues, when we catheterize the child, this is the gastric aspirate color, this is the urine color. Any idea? Any further clue for you? I may not be get your answers. So, can you sum up what could be the poison consumed? Yes, you are right. INH caused the convulsion in this child, but rifampicin gave the color. So both gastric aspirate and urine color was reddish. That was an additional clue. Later, when the child recovered, child confessed taking INH and rifampicin. And even the blood sample sent to the TB Institute in Chetpur showed that it contains isoniazid. So how do you manage isoniazid poisoning? The antidote is pyridoxine. It's a toxic doses. If the child comes with convulsion, intractable seizure, and altered sensorium, that means child has consumed more than 70 milligram per kg. It's a potential fatal dose. So it is something like what they give for Tulabharam to Tirupati or Unnikrishnan Udupi. You have to give weight by weight antidote. So the child has consumed 70 milligram per kg of isoniazid, then only child will have intractable seizures. It was a 40 kg child. So we need to give 2.8 grams of pyridoxine, which will be a real problem. Because INH is not available in IV injections, then we decided to give pyridoxine tablet crushed and given through the nasogastric tube. We gave almost 2.8 to 3 grams of pyridoxine tablet and some IM injections, and we are successful in saving the child. After 36 hours, we were able to extubate the child, and the pyridoxine orally saved the child. So, thanks to the team, Dr. Anita and Dr. Sharada managed the child. So, what the lesson learned from the child, whenever you face a puzzling emergency, consider poisoning as an important differential diagnosis. In our team member, allowed one young resident to sit aside and think about the poison, to refer books, to analyze and come with a solution. That will be really, really very useful. He need not be involved in the patient care. Remember, other common poisons causing convulsions are camphor and neem oil. You see the camphor, and even we will mistake it. Camphor, they closely resemble the sugar cubes. So naturally, child is likely to taste the camphor and cause convulsions. Neem oil is, most of our grandmothers think that neem oil is a good medicine for recurrent respiratory infection, but that is a very, very fatal, deadly poison. We have seen children coming in convulsions within 15 minutes of giving neem oil. The next case scenario, this is again an interesting case scenario. This is a 3-year-old child brought to ICHER in altered consciousness. He was irritable, tachypneic, very important clinical is cyanosis. We were able to see the pulse oximeter, saturation is 86. The cyanose and low saturation. But otherwise, he had mild tachycardia, pulses well felt, he was in altered sensorium. So what could be the possible poison? So the history, mother said, I given fish in the noon. Then I went out for work. When I returned, he was seen in the house lying unconscious. That was her history. So we thought poisoning may be an important possibility because you suspect, always suspect poisoning whenever there is a vacuum in the history. So mother knows the history till the noon, and around 7 p.m. he brought to the hospital. Nobody knows exactly what has happened between this 6 hours period. So there is a vacuum in history. Nobody can narrate the sequences. When you have a history like this, always think about poisoning rather than a disease or individual illness. So then we analyze. Only practical point we got was a cyanosis. So what are the causes of cyanosis? There are three causes. The child didn't have tachycardia or clubbing, so unlikely to be a cardiac etiology because no murmur, no clubbing. And respiratory causes will cause sinus only in the terminal illness, severe tachypnea, or apnea, bradypnea, pneumothorax, then only you'll have cyanosis. After excluding the cardiorespiratory causes, the third left-out possibility is, you know the diagnosis. What is the diagnosis? Most of us know about this. We thought of methemoglobinemia. This is the additional clue. You look at these pictures, the blood in a different containers. You see that this is the blood of the patient, chocolate brown colored. This is the patient's mother's blood. It's a bright red color. It's a normal one. This is chocolate brown color. Same way you can see the color of the blood. chocolate brown color, which shows confirm the diagnosis, a bedside test for methemoglobinemia. So, how methemoglobinemia can occur? What poisons can lead to? There are three important poisons: naphthalene balls, dapsone, and usage of local anesthetic like Emla cream. When you use local anesthetic, these are the three important causes for a child to develop methemoglobinemia, apart from the congenital causes. Very important learning point here we should all of us know is the saturation in the pulse oximeter was 86. But when we did the blood gas, you look at this, are able to see that the saturation here is 99.7. How so much a difference between the pulse oximeter and the ABG saturation, SpO2 and SaO2. This is called a saturation gap. Whenever you see saturation gap in any child with cyanosis, the diagnosis abnormal hemoglobin, most likely methemoglobin levels. So we took the sample and sent for co-oximetry. Co-oximetry is an additional benefit available in the ABG machines, available in the cardiothoracic centers. In 5 minutes, we got the results. You see that the saturation is 99.7. This is F-methem. This methemoglobin level was 35.8. Normal methyl level is less than 2%. If it is above 10%, they will become symptomatic. So this diagnosis of meth is confirmed. Now, the modern technology has given more comfort for us. This is a new machine based on SCT, new technology, the signal extraction technology, where the pulse oximeter itself gives the methemoglobin level. This is available in the ICH photo. This is available in ICH, so in the government institution. See here, the saturation, the pulse oximeter itself shows the amount of presence of methemoglobin. This is one of the very wonderful one which was useful for us at that time. So, now we confirm the diagnosis of methemoglobinemia. So, we have to go for the antidote, IV methylene blue. This happened in 2000 in our hospital in IC. We didn't have methemoglobin. We didn't have the methylene blue. We tried all the government and private hospitals in Chennai. We did not get it. 91 I can see. Everywhere we tried, we could not get it. Then finally, Chellam Kribaran madam from CMC, she expressed her willingness to help. We sent a person to collect IV methylene blue. He went to Vellur and collected. It took almost 12 to 18 hours. You know the cost of IV methylene blue? It's a methylene blue, ordinary one sterilized by the pharmacy, which costs only 3 into 4, only 12 rupees. But we have to wait for 12 to 18 hours. So that's a lesson we learned is we have to stock all the antidotes with us for immediate management. You can see the IV methylene blue. It is also being excreted in the urine. What is the dosage? Before giving IV methylene blue, we have to confirm that child does not have GCPD deficiency. We have to check the GCPD level prior to starting the IV methylene blue. 2 mg per kg over 15 minutes. We have to repeat 3 times. Maximum dose is 7 mg per kg. Child completely recovered and discharged well. The learning point is any dramatic onset, vacuum in the history, when no one can add the sequences, think about poisoning. Whenever you see saturation gap, think about methemoglobinemia and try to manage with IV methylene blue. 48 days old child, I'll just rush it because I've taken longer time in this thing. So 45 days old baby, this baby cried in the night. The grandmother who was sleeping with the baby, he went to the cupboard and took supposed to be the grape water bottle and administered to the baby in the night. So the baby, the crying spell stopped, but child developed respiratory distress and became quiet and developed grunting. Brought to the hospital ER, hope most of you can identify what has really happened. What you can see is a white necrotic patch indicative of a, you are correct, corrosive poison. The grandmother, the lesson learned here is we should not miss any medicine the night, particularly grandmother might have had cataract, may not know. She has given the bathroom cleaning agent kept in the grape water bottle. That's what happened. So when the child, generally a corrosive poison child comes to us, the first question we should decide is, the child needs intubation or not. Whenever there is a voice change, a hoarse voice or stridor, probably you have to call the anesthetist or intensivist. You have to gently intubate the child. Otherwise, if the time elapses even for 1 or 2 hours later, we may not be able to intubate. And respiratory distress and perforation is a serious complication following corrosive ingestion. These are all the various corrosives available in our own home. Acids are car battery liquid, rust cleaner, metal cleaner, disinfectant like phenol, which is available freely in the lockdown areas. Alkali, button batteries, bleach, all these are corrosives. The management is secure the airway, intubate early before the child worsens. And the child comes very early, within maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes, within 1 hour, you can give milk or water less than 15 ml per kg to dilute the acid. Lesson learned is don't give any medicine in the darkness. Never miss corrosive ingestion. Child comes to you with drooling of saliva, with erythema, ulcers in the tongue, and then change in the voice. Think about corrosive poison. This is again a complex case scenario. The 7-year-old boy, he and his sister was returning back from school. He saw a chocolate-like substance kept in the wall of near a well. Despite his sister's advice, he took that substance. So that's why, you know, whenever a lady advises you something, you have to accept it, because their advice is very valuable. So despite his sister's advice, this fellow did not listen. He took that substance. The next few hours landed in ICH ER, unresponsive, frothing. When he was examined by the ER physician, Dr. Shanti was on duty at that time, bradycardia, constrictive pupil, convulsions. The first thing in a constrictive pupil, first toxidrome, first drug, which first poison you will think is the OPC poison. But there are features against OPC, which are no muscle twitching, no hypersalivation. But despite that being the first possibility, the child was treated for OPC poison. Given P2AM and atropine, lorazepam was given for control of convulsion. But remember, there is another two more lists. Phenobarbital, opiate, and clonidine can cause constrictive pupil. The empiric did OPC poisoning, but the child did not improve. After 12 hours, we thought we will treat for a second differential diagnosis. We gave naloxone 10 microgram per kg as IV bolus followed by infusion. Within few minutes, he completely recovered. People became dilated and he started recovering. We have to convince him to stay for a few hours before we extubate, and the child completely recovered. So going through the toxidrome and analyzing the case, like consider people, these are the DDs, helped us to manage the child. The lesson is always think about differential diagnosis. Meiosis means seizures. Consider opiates next to OPC. Again, you might think that opium is not available in my home or in the hospital environment. Remember, fentanyl patch now used for as an analgesic following surgeries, Lomotil tablets, cough syrup with codeine, all this contains opiate, which can cause opiate poisoning. This is a 5-year-old child. Said to have consumed unknown number of thyroxine tablets about 3 hours ago. He was brought to the hospital. Child was looking well. Mother's mind was oscillating, whether it's consumed or not consumed. She was very much confused, and she also tried to confuse us. We don't know how to proceed. When I told her that the child needs observation, gastric lavage, everything, when I told, she did not accept it. I said, doctor, if the baby has not consumed thyroxine, when you do all these things, will it cause problems? I don't think it's consumed. At the same time, she is not willing to take the child also. So how to proceed? So what I realized was, I reassured the parents that I'm not going to do anything blindly. What I'm going to do is only a passing in the tube and wash out whatever is consumed or not. Then only we will think about antidote. I reassured the parents, convinced them, and pass an esophagic tube. To our surprise, to our acceptance, you see, this is the color of the thyroxine tablets. After showing the color, mother agreed for all the other managements. What is the problem with thyroxine is, we can manage with activated charcoal, gastric lavage. It can cause fever, vomiting, tachyarrhythmia, and cardiac failure is the worst complication. The problem with thyroxine ingestion is, up to 10 days, child can develop problems. There are case reports on 10th day, child developing cardiogenic shock and died. So we can't keep the child for 10 days. Maybe 48 hours, we can keep the child for evaluation, observation to prepare the parents. Then child can be managed as outpatient twice a day follow-up. Whenever child has fever, we have to anticipate an arrhythmia, need to be admitted. The child develop arrhythmia or fever, the treatment is managed with prednisolone, propranolol, and a new drug called iopinate or iopinic acid. We'll move on to, quickly I'll go on. These are the stories of a child is brought with drooling of saliva, and this was the X-ray taken. You might ask, why did you take an X-ray chest? Saturation is normal, no tachypnea, drooling of saliva and cough. We took an X-ray. To our surprise, there was a coin shadow here. So whenever a coin shadow in the neck, always think about some serious things. This happened in year 2000. And we called the ENT surgeon to remove the coin. The coin is in the coronal plane. It is in the cricopharynx. If it is in the sagittal plane, it is in the trachea. But it is in the coronal plane, so most likely cricopharynx. Surgeon, ENT surgeon came and tried to remove it at 10 p.m. in the ICH ER, but could not remove it. It was difficult to remove. Call for an anesthetic help. Anesthetists were busy with the neonatal surgeries in the theater. They said they'll be free only in the next day morning. Child was stable, so admitted in the ward because saturation was okay. And the child was taken in the first case in the morning around 8 o'clock. Child was removed. The button back, see, the coin shadow was removed. The foreign body was removed. And after removal, after about 8 to 10 hours, child develops severe distress. You can see the yearly here, septate emphysema, pneumothorax, pneumediastinum, and brought to ICU. Child has to undergo two ICDs. When we removed the coin and cleaned the coin, only we realized that it's not a coin, it's a button battery. That was in 2000, that was my first our first encounter with button batteries. At that time, the button batteries were very scarcely available. So in a button battery, in four places, you have to remove immediately. Nasopharynx, nose, cricopharynx, esophagus, you have to remove immediately because even within 4 hours, it can cause perforation. Simple clue is the double halo may be seen in the button battery, which may not be seen in the coin. This is a double halo. What you see here is may be seen in the button battery, but it's always wise to presume as button battery. Any coin should you presume as button battery and try to remove as early as possible, particularly if it's in the cricopharynx and esophagus. The pre-hospital advice, they come with the history that child has consumed a button battery. Before referring to a center where they can remove by endoscopy, the new advice now is you can give honey. 10 ml, that is 2 spoons of honey by mouth every 10 minutes for up to 6 doses. There are two indications for this. Child must be more than 12 months old, 12 months, more than 1 year old, and the child should have consumed this foreign body within 12 hours. Can you 10 ml, 2 spoons of honey by mouth every 10 minutes up to 6 doses. This will coat the button battery and prevent much erosions. And then later we have to advise the parents to keep nil oral because once they go to the tertiary care center, they have to give anesthesia and to remove the button battery. So educate the parents not to use button battery operated toys. If at all they use it, use the button battery which is fixed and screwed in the toy. This is a silent killer. A father and son were found unconscious. They were waiting for the mother who was taking treatment inside the ER overnight. They were waiting outside the hospital in the car with the AC run. They were sleeping. They were found to be unconscious by the police personnel and brought to the hospital. Child was in alter sensorium, irregular pulse and in shock, and saturation was 90%. Can you think what is the silent killer? A silent killer is carbon monoxide. The carbon monoxide doesn't have any smell or color. And so naturally, the victim will not realize that they are here. They are consuming something, an abnormal gas. Where the source of gas is from the AC of the car, in a closed AC of the car. Why the carbon monoxide causes the problem is the hemoglobin has got 200 times high affinity to carbon monoxide in compared to the oxygen. It's something like a boy who has got 200 times more affinity for the phone and computer rather than for the books. So it is bound to carbon monoxide. The suspect carbon monoxide poisoning in the usual circumstances. What are the circumstances? A child brought from the place, home, where common household items like gas fires, oil burning furnaces, portable generators, charcoal grills, chimneys, they all produce carbon monoxide, particularly when they are old and they are not properly serviced. Outside the home, a running car engine in an enclosed space like a garage, this was identified in the road in the rainy days. Many of them died in the car by running the AC to continue. Most of these patients, they do not come to the hospital. Why they don't come to the hospital? Because they die in the spot itself within few minutes. So they are seen only in the newspapers. So these are all the newspaper reports. Times of India reports in Chennai, 37-year-old man found dead in the car, suspected carbon monoxide poisoning. This is a BBC news. 50 people have died in the carbon monoxide poisoning in the Northern Ireland. It's in Hindustan Times. This here paper published in All News Medical Sciences. 40 cases of fatal carbon monoxide poisoning. So if they happen to reach the hospital, we must think any person coming from the suspected circumstance in an alter sensorium, we should think of carbon monoxide poisoning. The management is very simple. What to do is the management is give only oxygen, 100% oxygen. We can use the non-rebreathing mask. If in centers where they are available for hyperbaric oxygen, we can use it. If you use a 100% oxygen in a high flow oxygen, things in 100% oxygen and non-rebreathing mask, that itself will be enough to save the child. Only thing that we should think about this carbon monoxide poison, how to prevent it, avoid those situations, service or household items, or keep the door little open. Whenever we use AC, you know, we tightly close the windows and doors, thinking that the AC will be wasted, but keep a small gap in the doors and windows. AC may be wasted, but carbon monoxide, if at all produced, will not accumulate. This is the carbon monoxide indicator, which is available even in India. 11th standard old child, 16-year-old, she failed in mathematics exam. What is the remedy? She consumed rat killer. She consumed the paste on the first day And the second day she consumed the powder, and third dose she consumed cake in the same day evening. She reached our hospital the fourth day. By the time she reached, she was in alter sensorium, but maintaining saturation in the room air. Transaminases are high, LDH high, coagulopathy was there. So this toxidrome, we are seeing this acute liver cell failure in the background of poisoning, paracetamol, rotondecide, and valproate. You have to consider cake, powder, and phosphorus. Cake contains super warfarin, so they come with coagulation failure. Paste is the most dangerous, contains yellow phosphorus. This is a very, very serious poison. It's a high mortality. And we gave supportive management, monitor, we give therapeutic plasma exchange. By fourth day, she developed hypoglycemia and shock. Fifth day, developed menstrual bleed and excessive sleepiness. And fortunately, we have to ship the child to another hospital where she died. So these are all the mechanisms. So what I feel is early referral to a tertiary care center with PAC and hepatic support can improve the survival. You can see this report and then probably you can understand it. The losing a child at 16 years because of rat killer is not at all acceptable. So better that we refer to centers where there are hepatic support and PAC with plasma exchange facilities are available. So this is the aerial view of Madurai city. The Meenakshaman temple is in the center. Now all the whole city is built around the temple. This was built around 1000 years ago. If we borrow this concept, see, now all the hospitals borrow this concept, PAC in the center. The whole hospital beds are built around it. So early referral to a place where there are PVC facilities and hepatic support and therapeutic plasma exchange and transplants are available. These children can be saved if they are referred earlier. This is a report published from one of the hospitals in Chennai city. This is a study done between 15 to 18 study period. 30 patients were monitored. They underwent a therapeutic plasma exchange, average 5 procedures per day. The reactions are only 4 minor reactions, no major adverse reaction to therapeutic plasma exchange. Almost 28 were saved. They were discharged without transplant between 5th to 30th day. Only 2 recovered urgent transplant, 2 expired. So out of 30, 26 survived. 2 recovered liver transplant, 2 expired. So every child with rat killer poison, if facilities are available, therapeutic plasma exchange can save these kids. This is a newer modality available for those kids. I just want to touch upon these points on drug abuse in children. These are the two women writers in 70s. They wrote all revolutionary short stories, Sivasankari and Indumati. They wrote short stories and novels about drug abuse in the schools in 70s and 80s when the problem is not much. So think about drug abuse in our own kids or any patient. When you find this behavioral problems and poor grades in a well child, emotional distancing, hostility and irritability, a change in level of cooperation around the house. Lying and increased evasiveness about his presence about the school or weekend whereabouts. Decrease the interest in personal appearance. Physical appearance of bloodshot eyes, runny nose, frequent sore throats. Change in the mood. Unusual odor on breath, alcohol, inhalant, marijuana. Widely lighted people even in bright light. Pinpoint people even in the dim light. Suspect that this school kid probably got exposed to drugs. Now, this is an unknown leaf ingestion. A child went to a park and bitten and chewed an unknown leaf. What happened was he developed severe burning pain in the tongue and lips. He came with swollen tongue. This, I didn't have the picture of that. This is a case history taken from Indian pediatrics. This will be the picture, swollen tongue, secondary to chewing the leaves taken from the park. What is a leaf? These are all the plant. Even in our house, we had this. You know, these are all the commonly available plant in most of our houses, ornamental plants. This is called dumcan plant, Diffenbachia plant. This is a very, very irritant plant which can cause swelling of the tongue, may interfere with the oxygenation ventilation. Sometimes they may require even intubation. So this is one of the dangerous plant. When we keep at home, we must be very careful not to be handled by our kids. So how the plant poisons cause problems? One is oropharyngeal irritant. This is a dumcan plant. These irritant plants are castor oil, castor seed. Third is dermal irritant plants like stinging nettle and poison oak. And cardiac poison, all of us are familiar with oleander. You might be surprised why I'm keeping the images of an umbrella, some leaves, some small pellet, and there's a big plate or disc. So now we'll see an interesting story about a Giorgi Markov story. It's a very popular story. When you go through the net, you can identify that. Giorgi Markov is a popular writer. He's a dissident writer in Republic of Bulgaria. Then he defected to the England, he got a job in BBC and relocated to London. He went to London, he started a lot of criticizing remarks about the Republic of Bulgaria, and then Bulgarian Secret Service wanted to assassinate him. When after the BBC work, when he was waiting in the bus stop in the evening, he was waiting in the bus stop, this small bristle, he and another middle-aged man was there in the bus stop. The middle-aged man suddenly opened an umbrella. He was wearing an umbrella. The umbrella, the tip of the umbrella slightly scratched his thighs. It's a very small accidental event. He felt very sorry. And then George Mark smiled and said, okay, no problem. But he went home, and that night he developed fever and was admitted to a hospital in Belgaum. And then diagnosed as sepsis initially. Later, he died the fourth day. Because he was a double agent, postmortem was done, which was proved as raisin parenteral poisoning. Now we see this again. This is a mini pellet kept in the umbrella. Something a mini gun. So when someone opens the umbrella, immediately the pellet will be charged to the victim. The pellet is very small, 1.5 millimeter size. Very small pellet, you can see the pellet, very small. When you enlarge it, you can see this almost just like it. This containing the raisin toxin. This was also shown in one of the recent Tamil movies. It's a popular story. So the lesson is raisin, which is available in the castor seed, is poisonous when it is given in a parental dosage. These are all the various plant poisons. The castor seed is oleander, beautiful green, yellow and rose color. This is Uduvandhalai plant. So, this case scenario involves plant, alcoholic father, sufferings could not be tolerated by mother and two kids. They consumed some toxins and brought to the hospital. And the child was looking conscious, saturation was normal, but heart rate is slow, 50, bradycardia. Here the ECG, there are two ECGs here. This is, when you closely observe, the heart rate is 50, but you can see PQRS. Here, you don't see the PQRS. The P is separately seen, does not correlate with the QRS. This is simple sinus bradycardia. This is complete heart block. When you happen to see this, now you see the toxidrome. This is a myocardial depressant poison. A conscious child, normal saturation, no respiratory distress, only the heart is lower. So it's a myocardial depressant by the toxidrome analysis. This is the toxidrome causing bradycardia are Uduvandhalai, Arali seeds, rural cardiac poisons. Digoxin tablets, beta blocker and calcium blocker. These are all the poisons which can cause bradycardia. So analyzing them, the beta blocker will cause hypoglycemia, hyperkalemia and bradycardia. If you say hyperglycemia, think about calcium channel blocker, because beta blocker can be managed with dextrose, glucagon and insulin glucose. But calcium channel blocker may need insulin glucose and plus IV calcium gluconate. For all this, if the bradycardia is very severe, causing cardiorespiratory compromise, probably pacing is the only alternative. 3-year-old child consumed an unknown tablet, brought with convulsions, pupils dilated. Tachycardia, ventricular tachycardia, you see the ECG, ventricular tachycardia, convulsions. I have only 3 or 4 cases in the US, Rajendra. I'll finish it off fast. So, 3-year-old girl consumed unknown tablets. You have a clinical features are ventricular tachycardia, dilated pupil, slightly raised blood pressure. What do you think the poison? Yes, most of you are correct. It is tricyclic antidepressant. So tricyclic antidepressant, what are the clinical features? 3 C's and 1 A and 1 D. What are the 3 C's? Coma, convulsions, cardiac arrhythmia. 1 A is acidosis. 1 D is dilated pupil. So management is sodium bicarbonate is the antidote, chemical antidote. Give sodium bicarbonate IV infusion so that the pH is kept at above 7.45. For arrhythmia, use lidocaine. For shock, we have to use norepinephrine. Remember, for all the seizures occurring in a poisoned child, they have to give only benzodiazepine and phenobarbital. Phenytoin is contraindicated. So suspect myocardial poison whenever you come across bradycardia or tachyarrhythmia in a child with poisoning. Here, second setting is useful. This is a child K brought to hospital, 2-year-old boy, well till 9:30. 11 o'clock he brought with convulsions, afebrile convulsions. He was drowsy, lethargic, convulsion, and also had opisthenotic posture, admitted in ICU, asked about poisoning history because afebrile child, poisoning mother, the history was elicited around 1 a.m. in the night because child admitted to ICU at 12 o'clock. Mother stoutly refused, no, you would not have taken any medicine. Child is admitted in ICU, stabilized, and next day morning, quietly, I sat with the parents for a second elicited history, now 10 a.m. At night 1 a.m., I was also in a hurry and mother was also in a hurry. Morning 10 a.m., the child is stabilized. Second history, mother was clear in expressing the fact that she has been taking phenytoin and carbamazepine right from the age of 14. The first question I asked was whether there is any chance that child will consume poison. That question was no, the answer. You modify the question such a way that is any medicine available at home? That is a very good question. Mother answered, yes, carbamazepine and phenytoin is available in our home. I don't think you would have taken. I am regularly taking this medicine. That gave a clue and then turned out to be a carbamazepine poisoning. If we see a poisoning child, convulsions, altered sensorium and opisthotonic posture, carbamazepine may be a very, very important cause. We send a blood sample, confirm the presence of carbamazepine phenytoin. Mosquito repellent toxicity, most of the time they are not toxic, but they definitely need to be observed in the hospital for at least 24 hours because they can cause arrhythmia, convulsions, because there is a two case reports in Indian pediatrics that they developed, two siblings developed convulsions. So better that we hospitalize the child for observation, keeping on IV fluids, 24 hours monitoring of ECG and pulse oximeter. 18-year-old girl working in the electroplating industry brought to the hospital at 11 a.m. The history is she came for work at 10 a.m. Within half an hour, she developed convulsion, altered sensorium and brought to the hospital. This is another similar case history. A 4-year-old boy came to ER with nausea, vomiting, sudden loss of consciousness. Again, history is no trauma, no poisoning, but he was found to be eating apricot 1 hour ago. Within 20 minutes, he started vomiting and became unconscious. Saturation was normal. Developed convulsion, became unconscious. In both these cases, common finding was high anaerobic metabolic acidosis and room air saturation was normal with the elevated central venous oxygen saturation. If anybody developing problem within 15 to 20 minutes after consuming some poison, think about cyanide. So, on what circumstances will think about cyanide poisoning? Sudden collapse of an industrial worker working in jewelry workshop or electroplating industry, you think about cyanide poisoning, or a fire event with victim with coma or acidemia, attempted suicide within 15 minutes child developing convulsions, or ingestion of fruits or plants containing cyanogenic glycosides, apricot seed, even if you bite the apple seed, it can cause cyanide poisoning, and tapioca. So now the management has become simple with the availability of hydroxycobalamine. I'm just telling this, I have not treated any patient with cyanide poisoning. But better that we stop this. If we happen to see with this background, these are all treatable poisons. We can manage a patient, child or patient with hydroxycobalamin. It is completely treatable poison. I just skip this quickly. You'll go through that. These are all regional poisons suggested by my friend Dr. Tendil Kumar from Tanjavur. Kanai Enna is practiced in Tanjavur and Trichy for cold and cough. Probably they may contain trace of neem oil and camphor. That's why they may develop convulsions. They consume kanai ennai. Tani powder is a cow dung powder is used in Coimbatore, Salem areas. Yellow and green powder, ghee irritation, hepatotoxicity and CNS effects. Now, with the rigid control by the government, now the incidence is reduced. There is also another poison called Misakara Thailam, where this is imported from Singapore, contained methyl salicylate liniment. 1 teaspoon of methyl salicylate. Sendhil, I'm just coming to the last parts of the case scenario. I'll finish up in another 5-10 minutes.
No problem.
Misakara Thailam. Pardon?
No problem, please go ahead.
This liniment contains methyl salicylate equivalent to 7000 milligram of salicylate. I'll repeat, 1 teaspoon is equivalent to 50 tablets of aspirin, 150 milligrams. We might think that it's only 1 spoon, but equivalent to consumption of 150 tablets of 150 milligram aspirin. So, whenever somebody comes with consumption of liniment, think about aspirin overdose. Some recent developments on poisoning. This is surfactant usage for hydrocarbon ingestion, which you've already discussed. Intralipid is useful for resuscitation of cardiac poison. It acts like a sponge. Because of this pharmacodynamic property, it takes these drugs, beta blocker, calcium channel blocker, the intralipid takes, and it is very useful. And advanced organ support, liver failure support for children with rodenticide poisoning, or sometimes lung transplant for paraquat poison is the only option. Nowadays, ICUs are available with therapeutic plasma exchange and liver and transplants, which may not be available for everybody, at least for those who can reach these centers. Poisoning with very serious symptoms can be saved. I just want to stress upon this point, medication errors. Look at this, this we already discussed. Look at this prescription. This is a very clear handwriting, Pedialyte 1 bottle. Child with diarrhea, prescription was given. Father went immediately, got the medicine, went home, and then he gave Pedialyte. The Pedialyte was consumed within 4 hours. What he got was pedichloride instead of Pedialyte. He gave full bottle was emptied, and then after 4 hours he came to the pharmacy and asked for one more bottle, and then he asked the pharmacy person whether this Pedialyte will cause sleepiness. My child is too sleepy. He said no, not at all. Then he showed the empty bottle. That was a different medicine called the pedichloride. So we must be very careful. But finally, child survived. This is Diavol and Dianyl. Old people may remember in 70s and 80s there is a medicine called Diavol. It's a carminative. Instead of Diavol, many a time Dianyl was prescribed, and they landed with fatal hypoglycemias. In one occasion, in a vaccine center, in a multi-dose, measles was given instead of BCG. Multi-dose BCG was given instead of measles, because both will be similar looking. A multi-dose BCG, 20 doses were injected in the place of measles. All this can happen. We must be very, very careful about it. I generally, whenever I prescribe, I ask them to bring the medicine back and show it to my clinic. I always verify the medicine before they leave it. That is also create an impression that my clinic is very busy. Even though I see 10 patients, it will be looking like a 20. So when they come back and so many people will be waiting, it may give an impression that you are a very busy practitioner. But most of the time, it saves from all these problematic situations. These are some mystery, quick stories. The home, when I was working in the Kodaikanal Hospital, one homemade was brought, a 17-year-old boy was brought with altered behavior, fighting with the owner. He was brought there. I was thinking about some poisoning or some aberrant behavior. Then my pharmacist came and examined him and said, sir, he was looking, smelling of alcohol, sir. This fellow has consumed alcohol. In another situation, a child was brought with restlessness to the hospital ICGR, 10-year-old boy. The history was, Mani, he had a rat bite. A rat bite should not cause restlessness. They were worried because rat bite can cause something like a rabies. But I asked them the history. They said after the rat bite went to the local practitioner, he gave some local medicine, alternative medicine, which contained Datura. So Datura caused restlessness, not the rat bite. In another situation, an LKG girl was brought because she consumed $20 of oral contraceptive pills. Oral contraceptive pills is relatively benign. It won't cause much problem, except it may cause a withdrawal bleeding. So I gave some caution, reassured the parents that nothing will happen. A big number of attendees were came, father, grandparents, everybody came, uncle, niece, everybody. I reassured them and sent them back after gastric lavage. The grandmother, after reaching the gate, she came back running and asked me, sir, an LKG, even though an LKG girl, when she grew older, got married and pregnancy, will it cause any problem, the oral contraceptive pills? Will she have a normal pregnancy and childbirth? That was a doubt she wanted to clarify with me. In another occasion, three adults went to a wine shop, two came out, died in 5 minutes. This happened in working in one of the headquarters. Anybody dying at 5 minutes, that was my physician friend told that it is definitely cyanide. 5-10 minutes, death or serious symptoms, suspect cyanosis, cyanide poisoning. In another situation, the child is brought to the intractable hypoglycemia, uncorrected hypoglycemia. We asked about the medicine used. They brought a medicine. They had only the prescription showed, they had a prescription, showed only chlorpheniramine maleate and then paracetamol and antibiotic. This will not cause intractable hypoglycemia. What exactly happened was when you asked them to bring the medicine, wrong medicine was dispensed. But instead of antihistamine, paracetamol and antibiotic, what was dispensed was antihypertensive and oral diabetic, which was responsible for the intractable hypoglycemia. AND capsules. When I was in the surgical OP, during my house-searching days in the 70s, one well-dressed person came here for the prescription for AND capsule. Why AND capsule for an old man like me? So at the time, my house-searching colleague was interested in surgery. I asked him whether the AND capsule, he was operated for hydrocele. Why he is taking AND capsules? And we were suspicious why he has to take AND capsule. Will it have any effect to prevent further hydrocele or hernia? We asked him to bring the old OP ticket. He had a bunch of OP ticket. Very sincerely, 10 years he is coming to OP and collecting AND capsules. We were managed to take the first prescription. At that time he was a government servant, operated. The assistant professor wanted to give him medical certificate. He wrote to the office people to give admission discharge certificate, AND certificate. That was a short form used. Give AND. All the house surgeon for 10 years, we sincerely followed that AND. The unfortunate old man was coming and receiving AND capsule for 10 years. So we must be very careful about our prescriptions. Whenever even our seniors advise some drugs, we have to question why this was prescribed. These are some of the textbooks, some of the books which are very useful books available. This book is very useful, published from Raipata Hospital. Very, very useful book on manual of toxicology. This is a book published from IGPP, Handbook of Poisoning in Children. These are all the poison control information centers from AIIMS, MMC, Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences, CMC Vellore. I just take a photograph of these numbers, it's very useful. I just acknowledge, thank my colleagues who all helped me in bringing, planning and collecting this information. You only taken a tiny piece of apple, as per Steve Jobs. Small sample of poisoning we have tasted. Probably a lot of things we have to learn from this. I just, with the permission of Chendil, just an appeal for all the participants to subscribe for IGPP and support the cause of IGPP, which is our own journal. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Sorry for taking a little longer time.
Thank you, sir, for your extensive and wonderful presentation. It showed your knowledge, skill and application as a master teacher and teacher of teachers, and your experience in the AICU of Institute of Child Health. So we have learned so many things: the toxidrome approach, the gastric decontamination, the importance of activated charcoal, and you have put in every slide the lessons learned you have. And of course, you philosophically, you said that even everything in excess, love, money, power and oxygen, everything in excess, so it is all a wonderful presentation, sir. You were sorry for the technical issues. So I think we'll hand over the session for discussion to Rajendran and Ashmali.
Sir, first question, PAM studies has shown it is not very effective. What is your experience, Dr. Satish Kumar?
So there are many studies done in CMC and many places. There are for and against. But finally, WHO advises to give PTVM. But it is left to the discretion of the treating physician. If he is able to provide the supportive management like ventilation and atropine, probably that may be effective. The P2AM is still controversy, is not settled, but WHO advice still remains same that we can use P2AM. So it's left to the discretion of the physician who treats that child.
Okay. Another question, can NAC infusion be used in non-paracetamol acute liver failure by Dr. Dinesh?
Now it has become a practice because it's supposed to, how the NAC helps in non-paracetamol hepatic failure is, supposed to alter the microcirculation of the liver and thereby improves the perfusion of the liver and thereby is found to be helpful. These are all many studies have been done. It's become a routine practice now. A NAC is being used in most of the acute liver cell failure, even non-paracetamol induced. It is also extended to other poisons, something like the calcium channel blocker and chani pudi, all that they are using NSL system now.
In iron poisoning, why resuscitation with the RL in the presence of transaminitis and acidosis?
Of course, ringer lactate and normal saline are equivalents in correction of shock and acidosis. Sir, only there are three contraindications for thing. Only is the liver failure. Of course, it is early stage. That's why we use ringer lactate or invulnerable metabolism. Otherwise, I think ringer lactate and normal saline are equal listing, it may not aggravate acidosis. Only in late stages, when there is invulnerable metabolism or lactic acidosis, probably ringer lactate is contraindicated. This is very early stage, early hours. That's why I thought both RL and normal saline doesn't make any difference.
Another question from Samala, how to suspect unwitnessed scorpion or snake bite?
I didn't cover here because that itself is in a totally different topic. I feel that I have also come across many a time, suddenly a child started crying and then brought to the hospital. I've seen some few occasions. Few helpful, this thing is a well sleeping child suddenly cries, child is brought to the hospital, profusely sweating, cold extremities, tachycardia, bradycardia. Sometime even the priapism in a male child will be helpful. So we have to have a very strong suspicion about scorpion sting. We ask for the circumstantial evidence, like a thatched tiled house, sudden onset of child got up and crying. All this, we have to elicit the history, look for features to suggest pain sting like profuse sweating, tachycardia, bradycardia, hypertension, hypotension, is worthwhile giving prazosin in those situations if you strongly suspect. But nobody can prove that. A few occasions we have seen witnessed any child brought to the acute flaccid paralysis, we have to go through the whole thing. We have to remove the dress and look for any bite marks. In one occasion, we admitted the child as snake bite. And so when the child is GBS because of paralysis, one of her very curious nurse, she identified and called saying that, look at the feet, sir. There are two marks, probably look like fang mark. We cleaned the area with the cotton and then looked at it. It is a fang mark only. We really thank the nurse or the young resident. Most of the time, they will identify and indicate that there is a fang mark is there. When the circumstances are very strong, you can even give an empirical antisnake venom. So a child is playing in a park or in a garden area and coming and developing a flaccid paralysis, it's worthwhile to use. But when you are doing that, better you talk to the parents to prevent medical issues. And one occasion, when we use ASV, parents were not happy with that. We have to sufficiently prepare the parents that we are using this empirically because it's a life-saving medication. One fact we should remember is a crate will not cause much pain or local symptoms at the snake bite area. The crate bite, the fang mark is equivalent to the insulin pin needle. It's roughly about 30 size needle, like insulin pen. So the pain will be very minimal. Local chains are very minimal. They may not even perceive that snake has been bitten. One clue is abdominal pain. If a child is suddenly developing abdominal pain and weakness, you have to strongly suspect snake bite. And worthwhile giving anti-snake venom after sufficiently documenting and explaining to the parents.
Sir, Dr. Ismail, sir, can you take
over? So I don't have any questions, actually. I can't have
the
screen.
In the WhatsApp. Okay, I'm using... can you tell about if there's for the chalk powder poisoning, sir?
Chani powder, sir?
Chalk powder. Chalk powder. Chalk piece.
Generally, it must be benign only, sir. As far as I know, it's only benign because they may not consume large amount. But common poison which they ask for inquiry is usually the drying agent will be kept in most of the appliances like shoes and all, shoes, dress and all. There is a small pillow-like bag containing silicon pellets. That is non-poisonous. You need not worry about it. Chalk also, I feel it is non-poisonous. I have not come across any problem and they may not consume large amount of chalk. If you have any experience, please share, Senthil.
Okay. I don't have any experience.
Chani powder, do you mean chani powder or chalk powder?
Chalk, no, sir. Chalk.
Chalk powder, as far as I know, it's non-poisonous. If anybody has an occasion, chalk powder has caused problem, they can share with me.
Okay, sir. Another question is, why phenytoin should be avoided in seizures with suspected poisoning?
One is, most of the time, phenytoin also has a cardiotoxicity. So in the presence, like tricyclic antidepressant, most of the poisons may also has cardiac impairment. And plus, phenytoin has got a lot of drug interaction. Because of these two reasons, it's standard rule that you have to use a safest anticonvulsant. Safest anticonvulsant is only benzodiazepines, lorazepam or midazolam. Also phenobarbital, but phenobarbital it will cause severe heinous depression. We don't use it. So benzodiazepine is the best choice for all seizure caused by toxins. Phenytoin is avoided mainly because of cardiotoxicity as well as about the drug interaction.
So what is the best website to look for in common childhood poisoning in India?
There are a lot of websites. A website does not contain all those things. Like for example, AIIMS has got a website, but most of the hospital websites has materials are not immediately available. They don't have the list of all the poisons. But when you raise a question, most of them will give an answer. Contact this number and ask for a query. You will get an answer within 2 minutes. You know, by telephone, you can contact and get the answers.
So what is the mortality in camphor poisoning?
Camper is almost nil mortality, sir. I have seen the last maybe 20, 30 years, we have seen a lot of camper poisoning. Camper is relatively benign. It causes convulsion, but only one or two occasion only. Once with one or two dose, lower supplement, convulsion gets controlled. But worst thing is neem oil. I have seen neem oil deaths very frequently when I was in ICHIC. Because neem oil is so powerful, it causes convulsion within 10 to 15 minutes of administration, needing lot of anticonvulsions, multiple anticonvulsions, prolonged ventilation. I have also seen deaths. The reason, this is there was one study done in Madurai Medical College. One of the PG's thesis was, the neem as such was not toxic. What they proved that, neem has been used as a medicine in our area for a long time. To increase the bitterness of the neem, the producers in the industrials, they use strychnine along with that. That was the proof they have showed. Probably that might have been the reason for this intractable seizures in neem oil poisoning. The neem oil is the worst. Camphor generally get relieved with one or two dose of lorazepam.
Well, are you ready?
Hello?
Ismail, is you ready?
Yeah.
Okay. You can take some questions.
Yeah.
Please go ahead.
The role of flumazenil in lorazepam poisoning?
The flumazenil is a double-edged weapon. One is, most of the time, the benzodiazepines, we had one child who was consumed antidepressant and came with poisoning features, ataxia. Most of the time, they can be symptomatically managed. If they need, we can intubate and ventilate. All that can be done. But the flumazenil is a double-edged weapon. Sometimes flumazenil will cause more problem by causing problems, convulsions. So generally, flumazenil is a little more dangerous. And even the most of the textbook advice not to use flumazenil unless it is after giving supportive measures, still the depression is so severe, then we can go for flumazenil. But generally, flumazenil is a double-edged weapon not to use. Because most of the children with the benzodiazepine poisoning, they will have only respiratory depression, which can be managed by ventilator support.
Okay. So the other question
should be very cautiously used. The flumazenil should be very cautiously used.
Cautiously.
Because of more dangers than benefits. Another similar antidote is physostigmine. Also, that's also more problem than benefits. These two antidotes, physostigmine and flumazenil, has to be used very, very cautiously because their problems are more than the advantages.
I'll go to the next question, sir. Is MLC mandatory in snake bites and scorpion stings?
Yes. Scorpion sting, no. But MLC, yes. I tell you the two reasons, sir. One reason is, in villages, earlier days, I don't know now, but it's not happening. Most of the time, many homicides have been brushed aside as snake bites. So, that is one reason. Second reason is, Tamil Nadu government, they were giving compensation for snake bite victim like a rural accidents. For that reason, they need a postmortem and medical certificate. I don't know whether the same thing exists because I worked in headquarters hospital for more than 15 years earlier. At that time, that was a practice. Now, I don't know whether the same rule exists or not. These are the two reasons. To ensure that homicides are not covered as snake bites. Number two is to give compensation given by the government. They need a postmortem and certificates. Death certificate. And scorpion sting, there is no need. But other poisons, it is safer always to safeguard the medical personnel to make an ER entry, even for paracetamol, kerosene, because the make an ER entry, what we generally do is we call the parents and tell them. If you leave it as a surprise, if you don't tell them and suddenly police comes and start inquiring, naturally he'll be totally unprepared. So he'll be very furious at the doctor. So what we do is whenever we make an ER entry, I tell the residents to talk to the parents. It is mandatory for all the hospitals, a government order. It's an accident register. It's nothing like anything serious. Any accident happens and brought to the hospital, it should be entered in the hospital records. That is called accident register. So we'll make an entry and inform the police. When the police comes, you tell the same thing. Like child suddenly took the medicine and consumed. That's all. It's a very, very benign explanation. Most of the time, parents will not be harassed. So when you tell them, when they are prepared, when the police come, they will not be having any problem. The problem will arise only when we don't tell them. Making an entry is safeguard the doctor. The child dies or there is some twist in the history or some different angle in the investigation, then we will be put into problem that we wanted to cover the mistake.
Sir, the next question is, how honey helps in button battery ingestion?
Which one? Honey? Honey, and they say that forms a coating around the. This is only recent development, the last 2-3 years only. Even in the Western textbooks, Western centers, poison centers advise, this forms a coating or the button battery. And for that, we should know how the button battery causes problems. Button battery, because of the large size, causes mechanical compression necrosis. Second, electrical discharge. Most importantly, it contains strong alkali. Strong alkali corrosion causes perforation. That is the reason for all the complications. The child who we lost mainly came with the perforation of the esophagus, mediastinitis, and all the complications. So the honey is supposed to coat the button battery so that doesn't prevent the contact to the GI mucosa. Thereby, the perforation is prevented. But remember, that is not a final solution. It's only a temporary solution till the button battery is removed. That should not make them to sit at home and give only honey. That should be explained to the parent that this is only a temporary measure till you reach the hospital. That will not replace removal of the button battery.
Nice, sir. Thank you, sir. The other question is cyprohepatidin poisoning, sir. The word about cyprohepatidin.
I don't know because nowadays I have not seen the cybermethrin or cyprohepatidin. Cyprohepatidin I have not seen for the last time. I don't know. I don't have idea, sir. I have not treated
cyprohepatidin.
Anybody has the same, can share that.
Why thyroxine tablet poisoning be treated with steroids, sir?
This is the I don't know the mechanism behind it. This is supposed to help. Steroid, I don't know the mechanism. Steroid, beta blocker is symptomatic drug. Steroid, I don't know the mechanism, it's supposed to help. And third is the iopanic acid. Iopanic acid, I have not come across, I have not seen that. Mechanism, I don't know, but it's being advised in the books.
Pregnant lady took tricyclic antidepressant, treated. What about fetus? She should undergo MTP. She was in first trimester.
So TCA poisoning?
Yes, sir. Tricyclic antidepressant poisoning, pregnant lady. She's in the first trimester. Okay. What about the fetus? Whether she should undergo MTP?
So that is a very, very big list. I can't remember. That's just like a dictionary. You have to refer a book to see what is the risk levels. You can't offhand, nobody can say. Probably you have to refer a book to see what is the level of risk. Because these are all very tricky decisions. Nobody can say just like that. You have to refer the book, refer the recent guidelines and advice, then only we can advise. Because it's a very, very major decision. Termination is a major decision. So we have to have proof, then only we can advise. I don't know now.
The last question is, good night liquid and solid piece consumption is very common. How to proceed, sir?
The good night liquid, which I think I shown a slide, mustard repellent, contains pyrethroid. It is available in this thing and also in Lakshman Rega. This is supposed to cause, they are more potent against the mosquito and insect rather than human beings. So generally, they are least toxic, but in large quantities, they can cause problems like arrhythmia, convulsions, extrapyramidal reactions. So this is a very rare occasions, but still, we have to hospitalize the child, gastric lava, charcoal, and then keep the child in hospital for at least 24 hours. If we happen to see the serious side effects, we can manage. Otherwise, we can discharge after 24 hours. Neurological complication, cardiac complications. And stomach loss is a little controversial. If it is a liquid, in most of the mosquito repellent liquid, they use kerosene as a maintain the liquid. So, stomach loss is a little contraindicated. If they consume a liquid, like good night liquid, when you give stomach loss, it's like a hydrocarbon, it will evaporate and then worsen the aspiration pneumonia. So, if it is a liquid, better not to do stomach loss, but you can give charcoal, monitor for convulsion, extrapyramidal reaction, as well as for arrhythmia. For 24 hours with pulse oximeter, ECG monitor, and you can discharge. There is no antidote, only supportive management.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for your patient answering.
One more. All accidental infections should be made MLC, sir.
That is answered. That is answered. You have any questions, Rajendra?
Yeah, MLC is safer. Safer for the doctor. Nothing wrong in making air entry.
Okay, sir.
One more question.
Thank you.
What is the role of gastric lavage and the activated charcoal in camphor poisoning, as there are few studies supporting while others they don't support?
Yeah, this is a very, very interesting question. See, one thing you should remember that charcoal should be given after the gastric lavage. You give the charcoal and do the lavage, everything will take it out. So first you do the gastric lavage, then give the charcoal. All the general contraindication of gastric lavage is hydrocarbons. Camphor is also a hydrocarbon, but hydrocarbon, among the hydrocarbon, this is the only thing where we can do gastric lavage. In hydrocarbon, generally gastric lavage is contraindicated. I told you three C's: hydrocarbon, comatose child, or child with respiratory distress. So in camphor, we can do gastric lavage. That is the only hydrocarbon where we can do stomach wash.
Okay, thank you, sir. We had a 529 login, sir. I think really happy and really.